Okay, so today we are going to continue with a new topic, which is IBS content scoring system. Okay, today we are going to learn on how we can calculate the IBS score. Okay, so this topic is quite important because this is part of your assignment, whereby you need to calculate the IBS score of your proposed project, which I've given you a few weeks ago. So before we start, let's recap what you have learned for the past 3 weeks or the past three lectures. Okay, with the topic of, firstly, we are talking about the type of IBS, which is steel framing system. Okay, so I prepared the pre-recorded video. I think all of you have watched all the videos, and I hope you have a clear understanding on steel framing system. Okay, so after that, the next following week, we move on to the next types of IBS, which is timber framing system. Okay, on the timber framing system, the most important part is the innovation that has been done on timber industry, okay, which known as glulam, okay, glue laminated timber. So by having this glulam, we can see the application of timber as a structural system on a bigger scale, okay, dalam projek yang lebih besar lah. Okay, so hopefully it will get support from construction players in Malaysia, but so far we haven't seen the development in Malaysia using glulam, except in Tebrau, Johor lah, as a benchmark, okay, for construction players to have a look that it is possible to use glulam as a structural system for bigger scale, for bigger projects. And last week, we have looked on the topic of the last type of IBS, which are block work and also innovative system. Okay, so we have covered all the types of IBS lah. Okay, three by Sir Reza and the other three by myself lah. Okay, so today we are going to learn on how we can calculate the IBS score. I share the screen first. Okay, can you see my slide? Boleh?
Boleh.
Alright. So again, as I mentioned earlier, today we are going to move on to the lecture 4, which is about IBS content scoring system. Okay, this slide, I made a little bit correction yesterday. Okay, I noticed ada few mistake in the calculation part lah later on. Okay, after this session, I'm going to upload the new one in the future. Nanti yang lama tu saya akan delete lah. Okay, saya akan upload the new one dan you can download. Okay, a little bit dia ada few changes saja. Alright, so this is the outline for today's lecture. Okay, before we have a look on how we can calculate the IBS score, we are going to touch a little bit on the concept of buildability. Okay, which is very, which is the concept that has been applied in Singapore, our neighboring countries lah. Okay, even though it's a different name, concept of buildability, but the application, the way it has been implemented is quite the same in Malaysia lah. Okay, so kat Malaysia we call it as an NIBS. In Singapore, they call it as a concept of buildability. Okay, buildable design. Okay, itu kat Singapore panggil. Alright, kita pakai IBS. Alright, and then after that, we are going to have a look on IBS, the IBS content scoring system, which is a manual, which is a construction industry standard developed by CIADB. Okay, so nanti we are going to have a look why this IBS score has been developed, on what basis, on what reason, and then we are going to have a look on the principles involved in IBS score. Okay, you need to know all these things before we can start calculating the IBS score. And then there are a few elements that you need to know. maybe she involved competition or IBS score, IBS form factor, formula involved, okay, or what are the rules before you can start calculating the IBS score. And then I'm going to show you two examples on how we can apply the IBS score. Okay, so today we are I am going to show you theoretically on how you can apply the formula involved in calculating the IBS score. Next week we are going to do the exercises together. Okay, so don't worry if you didn't get much understanding on how you can calculate the IBS score. Hopefully by next week, when we did the exercise together, hopefully you can get better understanding on how you can apply the formula involved in calculating the IBS score. Okay, because it's a calculation punya topic. Okay, so you need to do exercise lah. It's not enough by giving a lecture. I'm afraid you are not you didn't get 100% understanding on how to calculate the IBS score. And the last part of today's lecture, we are going to have a look on the successful adoption of delivery concept in Singapore. Okay, we are going to have a look on how Singapore did in successfully implementing the concept of buildability. Okay, IBS lah dekat Singapore, kita tengok nanti macam mana dia buat. Because most of the time that what has been done in Malaysia is based on what has been done in Singapore. Okay, most of the time lah. Okay. Alright, before we go into detail about IBS score, let's have a look on the concept of buildability. Okay. So what is the meaning of buildability actually? Okay. As you can see in the slide, before we go into the detail about the how we can define buildability, we have a look on what is the common problem faced by the construction industry. Not only in Malaysia but around the world. Okay, so the problem is that as you can see here, design details are sometimes very difficult and even impossible to construct. Okay, who being responsible to design? Okay, of course the designers team lah, which involve especially the architect as the key players in designing something, in designing building whatever. Okay, so what has been done by the architect, usually they will design whatever they want, okay, without considering problems which the contractor has to face on site. Okay, so they did not consider whatever problems that the contractors will face on site. What they know is that whatever they design must be completed, must be translated into reality. Okay, dalam yang dia orang imagine on the piece of paper, dalam guna komputer ke AutoCAD ke dan sebagainya, whatever they design must be translated into reality. Okay, dia tak kisahlah macam mana kontraktor nak buat, janji apa yang diorang imagine, apa yang diorang design tu jadi. Okay, without considering the problem faced by the contractor. Okay, that's the issue. Okay, so here why we have this issue, because there is a fragmentation between the designer and construction practitioners, which is the contractors lah mainly. Okay, apa yang dimaksudkan dengan fragmentation? Ada pengasingan, terasing. Okay, why there is a fragmentation? Because there is a contract, okay, between architect and also contractor. Okay, masa design stage kita tak tahu, we don't know yet who are the responsible contractors for this particular design. Okay, sebab kita masih ada contract, kita terpisah dengan contract. Except if you involve in a design and build punya project. Okay, I'm not sure when you are going to learn about procurement method. Syllabus baru ni saya masih tak familiar lagi. Okay, but you're going to learn on procurement method, which involve traditional method. Okay, yang biasanya kita open tender, contractor bid, and then the client will pick the most suitable contractor based on price, based on previous work and so on. Okay, so that's why we call it the traditional method of procurement. Okay, kita ada modern procurement, kita ada as I mentioned just now, design and build. Okay, kita ada turnkey project. Okay, so most of the procurement yang kita ada ni menyebabkan masalah ni berlaku tadi. Okay, fragmentation dia. Okay, kecuali design and build. Okay, design and build kita dah tahu dah contractor siapa. So dia boleh ada direct communication. Okay, the key point here, we cannot have a direct communication between designers and also contractor, architect and also contractor during the design stage. Okay, tak boleh ada direct. Direct communication tu maksudnya architect boleh tanya contractor, okay, kalau aku design macam ni kau boleh buat tak? Susah tak nak buat dan sebagainya. Okay, so dia dipisahkan oleh contract. So that's the issue. Okay, so how we can overcome this issue by implementing this concept of readability. Okay, that's come into picture, the idea of implementing the concept of readability. Sebab kita nak mengurangkan or we want to create indirect communication. Okay, so walaupun dipisah dengan kontrak, tapi kita boleh create indirect communication whereby whatever design made by the architect can be completed by the contractors without much problems. Okay, of course there will be problems, tapi kita tak nak problem yang agak sukar untuk diatasi oleh contractor. Okay, so this is how we can define the concept of readability. Okay, it's about the share of responsibility. The share of responsibility of those of all those disciplines who constitute the multidisciplinary building team, including architect, engineering, surveyor, building contractor, subcon. So whatever involved in the construction project must realize their responsibility. Okay, so it's a teamwork. Okay, it's not only about architect, dia punya kerja buat design dia. Dah siap design, dia dah tak ambil tahu dah. Lantak kau apa nak jadi. Okay, we don't want like that. Okay, we want to create a new environment whereby all involved in that particular project must have a teamwork. Okay, whereby they help each other. Okay, so architect bila dia siap design, maybe dia boleh consult the contractors that has been selected. Okay, this is the way you need to do it and so on. Okay, so again, as I mentioned by Griffith ni, not the individual responsibility of the architect. Okay, so it's a share of responsibility lah. That's how we can define readability. In other words, readability also can be defined as the ability to construct a building efficiently, economically, and to agree quality level from its constituent material, components, and sub-assembly. If from this definition, we can say that this concept of readability can be achieved when you adopt IBS in your construction project. Okay, kalau if you use IBS as your construction method, starting from design stage, you can achieve the idea of readability. You can reduce problem, you can reduce fragmentation punya issue, and you can create indirect communication between designers and also contractor. Okay, so that's the basic thing about readability. Readability ni lah. In other words, it's quite related with the implementation of IBS. And once you implement IBS, concept of readability will come along. Okay. So what are the principles of readability? Okay, as I mentioned just now, this is two key players involved in a construction project. Okay, designers and also constructor. Okay, designer ni especially the architect lah. Okay, constructor ni especially the contractors. Okay, can be main con and subcon dan sebagainya. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, both players are being separated by contract. So we cannot have direct communication between these two because kita ada contract. Kita tak tahu lagi siapa contractor kita, siapa yang akan terpilih. So in order to make sure we can create indirect communication, as I mentioned earlier, that's the main idea of implementing the concept of readability. Okay, we want to create indirect communication. The designers must design something based on these four principles. Okay, which are function and performance, readability, aesthetics, and also cost. Okay, so they must create something that has function and that can increase the performance of the overall projects. Okay, they cannot design something that only have aesthetic value saja. Okay, dia kena ada something yang bukan dia buat tu sebab cantik je. okay, mesti ada function, mesti ada fungsinya. Okay, tak boleh ada estetik saja. Alright, so that's the first principles that the architect need to consider. And of course, the element of durability means that they need to consider by the using of IBS in their construction project. Okay, so durability ni IBS, right? So they kena consider the IBS that will be used in the construction project. And of course, the aesthetic value kita tak boleh buang because this is the one of the key ingredients of architect punya design. Okay, they, of course, they nak create something yang ada aesthetical value. Alright, and the last principle that the architect need to consider is about the cost as well. Okay, because previously architect will design something that they will design something without considering the cost. Okay, they tak consider cost. Okay, so now when they want to design something, they need to consider about the cost. Okay, if they design A, for example, how much is the cost? Or if too expensive, maybe they need to alter a little bit, make a design B, for example, different design. Okay, so that's the thing that the architect need to consider. Okay, when the designer or when the architect follow all these principles, and the design will be completed. Okay, when the design has been completed, the contractor will be responsible to construct the design, to translate the design into reality. So the contractor also have their own what we call it as principle that they need to follow, so that the design that has been made by the architect must be completed within these three principles, which are agreed quality level. So the contractor must be responsible to follow whatever quality level that has been agreed in the agreement or in the drawing specification. Kalau the spec ask you to use concrete grade 30, follow accordingly. Alright, so again, kena guna IBS. Okay, as the design is being made based on IBS, so they kena follow IBS, and they need to complete the project within the approved cost. Okay, kita tak nak cost yang ada extra cost dan sebagainya, kalau boleh. Okay, even it is quite difficult lah, most of the project sometimes cost dia akan incur ataupun akan naik. Okay, ada banyak faktor yang mempengaruhi lah. Okay, so this is the principles of durability that the architect and also the contractors need to follow. Okay, so some of the design characteristic about durability, okay, which involve 3S. Okay, the first S is standardization. Okay, so standardization, we are talking about repetition of grid, sizes of component, connection of detail. Okay, every these three element must be standardized. Okay, grid. Okay, kita punya, if you notice dalam drawing kita, apa ni, layout, kalau boleh, if possible, standardize the size. For example, like if we involve in a high-rise project, okay, floor-to-floor height, okay, standardize it. Okay, from ground floor sampai lah tingkat 40 ke tingkat 50 ke, standardize the floor to floor height. Okay, sizes of the component, okay, standardize as much as possible. Okay, for example, like kita size column kita, let's say kita ada in our project we are using 200 column, for example. So if possible, all the 200 columns, the sizes must be standardized, sama je. Okay, kita tak ada column ni size lain dan sebagainya. Okay, try to make it standardized. A connection of details. Okay, if you involve, for example, like steel framing, okay, we are going to use either welded or bolted connection. Okay, so in this case, perhaps we can standardize it by using only one type of connection, for example, like welded charger. Okay, so make it easy. Alright, the other S is simplicity. Okay, ini bukan productivity. Simplicity. Okay, so we are trying to make an uncomplicated building construction system. Okay, try to make it simple as much as possible. Okay, and the installation also must be simple. Don't make it complicated. Okay, because if you notice, IBS is about standardized and simplicity lah. Okay, kalau boleh kita nak try to reduce difficulties by the contractors on site. Okay, so make it easy. And the last S is single integrated elements. Okay, so a single integrated system, element that combine components together. Okay, if possible, we want to have a lot of component that can be combined together. Okay, I think Sir Reza have touched on this. We are talking about modular construction. Okay, so we are talking about toilet unit. Okay, I'm not sure whether Sir Reza have touched it or not. I think in under topic precast code, okay, we have a volumetric system dengan semi volumetric. Okay, ini yang dimasukkan dengan single integrated system. Okay, we can construct toilet unit at the factory. Okay, kita bagi kat manufacturer size of toilet kita, apa services yang ada, finishes dia, tile ke, kita nak siap pasang kat kilang siap-siap, sampai kat site kita terus letak dia toilet. Itu dipanggil toilet unit. We have staircases, okay, itu pun antara contoh single integrated system. We have manufacturers that can combine column and beam at the factory and deliver to the site as well. Okay. And beside these three, this is other key features of durability design. Okay, more or less it quite related to this 3S ni tadi lah. Okay, usage of component, employment of MC, okay, modular coordination, okay, standardized modular column beam sizes as I mentioned earlier. Okay, repeated structural grid, if possible vertical repetition is 100%, horizontal 60%. Okay, column and beam group and confined to few sizes, okay, ni repetition. Column beam sitting directly on pile caps, rough foundation, system toilet, staircase, caging, mesh of reinforcement, standard modules, windows and doors. It is about standardization lah. Okay, this is the design characteristic that you need to consider when you want to use the concept of durability in your construction project. Okay, next we are going to have a look on the comparison between unbuildable design and also buildable design. Okay, traditional versus IBS, in other words. Okay, firstly we have a look on the unbuildable structural system. Okay, remember structural system ada tiga komponen: column, beam and also floor. Okay, flooring kita, slab kita. Alright, this is unbuildable design. Okay, this is the traditional method of construction. As you can see, it's scaffolding, formwork. When you're using formwork timber, okay, how messy the site is, serabut nampak kan? Okay, so site you pun cannot be safer, cannot be neater, cannot be cleaner as you want. Okay, this is buildable system. Okay, buildable structural system. Okay, if you're using flat plate, okay, if you're using precast slab, this is the integrated precast and column. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, okay, kita combine precast dengan column dekat site, then bawa ke site, dekat factory dan deliver to the site. Okay, precast beam, okay, this is what we call it as a buildable structural system. Okay, your site lebih tersusun lah, okay, tak adalah messy macam you guna unbuildable. Okay, this is just now using precast. Yang ini saya tunjuk contoh guna steel. Ini guna formwork. Alright, so this is also buildable system, structural system using steel. As you can see, your site lebih bersih lah. Okay, so this one using formwork. Okay, even though banyak komponennya, tapi taklah seteruk when you using timber formwork. Okay. Alright, next we have a look on wall system. Okay, buildable versus unbuildable versus buildable. Okay, we have a look on unbuildable wall system. You're using traditional brick wall. Okay, you lay the bricks floor by floor, layer by layer. Okay, you imagine kalau bangunan you 10 tingkat, you nak lay batu-bata ni 10 tingkat, berapa lama you perlu masa. Okay, compare to buildable wall system. Okay, so a lot of innovation has been done on the precast especially. Ok, Okay, as you can see here, kalau dulu kita boleh buat precast component wall-wall saja. Okay, sekarang ni kita boleh ada architectural finishes. Okay, even we can produce coloured precast facade wall at the factory. Okay, dekat kilang dah kita boleh cat siap-siap dah. Okay, bawa kat site tinggal pasang je. Alright, and of course ni normal precast facade, and of course we nowadays we can produce precast facade with aircon leach. Okay, tempat point aircon. Alright. And next, the last one is features, okay, unbuildable versus buildable features. Okay, ini contoh unbuildable features whereby we are talking about staircase, okay, traditional way of constructing the staircase, okay, using formwork, okay, cast in situ bare windows, also a traditional way of constructing the bare windows, okay, compared to buildable punya technique, okay, whereby this is a staircase tadi, okay, we can produce this staircase at the factory, deliver to the site and install it, okay, precast bay windows, okay, nowadays we have precast balconies, yes, here, as you can see here, alright, and we have precast boundary wall, and we have precast meter chamber, alright, so that's among the building features that can be developed using the concept of buildability. Okay, so that's the comparison lah. Okay. Alright, so that's some introduction on the concept of buildability. Okay, how it's quite related to IBS lah actually. Okay, cuma the name itself is quite different. Okay, whereby it is widely used in Singapore lah. Okay, but relatively it's more the same macam kita lah sebenarnya. Okay, next we are going to move on to the most important part of today's lecture, which is about IBS core lah. Okay, before we go into detail about the objective and the content of the IBS core, let's I share you a little bit history of when and how this IBS core has been introduced in Malaysia. Okay, so I think Sir Reza, I have explained to you regarding the history of IBS in Malaysia. Okay, which has been started in 1964. Okay, when government of Malaysia sent a representative from JKR and also KPKT to European countries to learn about IBS. And then they bring back the technology and implemented to two pilot projects, which is on flat keliling and also flat raffle places, I think, in Penang. Okay, so there are two pilot projects in late 1960s. Okay, and after that, kita boleh nampak penggunaan IBS makin lama when times go along there is an increment in the usage of IBS sampailah pada satu tahap the government decided that this IBS construction method is the way forward for our construction industry in Malaysia. So I think in the late 1990s and early 2000 barulah government kita put a serious effort in implementing it, encouraging the construction players in Malaysia to use IBS. Okay, barulah kita ada proper roadmap, barulah kita developed by CIDB, barulah CIDB develop proper roadmap, few incentive, okay, initiative done by the government, of course by especially by CIDB to promote the usage of IBS in our country. Okay, late 1990s or early 2000. Okay, barulah government kita put a lot of effort to promote IBS, okay, to make sure construction players are ready to use IBS. Okay, so when the times flies, at a certain stage, the government, of course, the government with CIDB identify that there is a loophole in the overall roadmap of the IBS. Okay, whereby they think that we need some instrument that can be used by the contractors or by the construction players to measure their usage of IBS in their construction project. Okay, dia perlukan sesuatu. Okay, whereby if you notice masa agama kita keluarkan arahan, for example lah, government project kena gunakan 50% IBS, lepas tu sekarang 70% IBS. Okay, government, every government project must use at least 70% IBS. Okay, I think Sir Reza dah sentuh pasal ini. Okay, kena guna 70% IBS. Okay, untuk government project yang bernilai 10 juta ke atas. Okay, whereby private project, the government encourage them to use IBS at least 50%. Okay, private project dia tak wajibkan. Tapi untuk government project dia wajibkan 70%, private sector 50% digalakkan. Okay, they give numbers. They give benchmark to contractors to follow in terms of the usage of IBS. But they need something, some mechanism on how they can calculate the usage of IBS from those contractors. Okay, macam mana dia nak monitor? Okay, macam mana dia nak make sure that that contractor gunakan 70% IBS? Okay, takkan nak datang site nak check, okay, berapa banyak IBS you pakai? Dah lebih 70 lah, contractor dekat 80. Okay, macam mana you tahu 80? Okay, dia cerita je. Yang ni pakai ni IBS, IBS dan sebagainya. Okay, so that's why the CIDB launch this IBS content scoring system in 2005. Okay, 2005 dia keluarkan this manual supaya dia, this manual akan jadi guideline untuk contractor gunakan untuk calculate dia orang punya IBS score. So lepas ni tak boleh nak cakap assume saja. Tak boleh. Sebab kita dah ada cara nak calculate macam mana. So contractor kena tahu macam mana nak calculate. So bila client datang check ke nak tanya berapa persen IBS pakai, you ada proof, ada backup, ada justification. Okay, I dah calculate, this is the score. Okay, kita dapat 90, kita dapat 100 ke. Alright, so that's datangnya IBS score ni dekat Malaysia in 2005. First version of IBS content scoring system. Okay, after 5 years in 2010, CIDB revised. Okay, they found something, they found some area that need to be improved. Okay, so after 5 years, they revised the content of the manual and then they introduced a new one in 2010. Alright, so after that, after 8 years in 2018, barulah they revised sekali lagi. They, adalah new things that they include in the manual. And currently, we are using IBS Content Scoring Manual 2018. Okay, yang terbaru, 2018. Okay, so later on nanti saya akan tunjuk perbezaan dia lah. Okay, dia, apa yang dia government kita adjust atau CIDB tukar. Okay, so that's a little bit history of IBS Content Scoring System. Okay, ini yang terbaru, manual ni. Ini saya dah masukkan dalam YouFuture. Okay, you boleh tengok lah. Okay, so ini detail lah. Okay, but the slide saya dah simplify kan. Saya dah ambil yang penting-penting. Okay, ini yang terbaru 2018. This is what we call it a construction industry standard lah. Okay, which calculation guide for the contractor. Okay, apa objektif dia sebenarnya? Okay, the objective of this IBS content scoring system is to provide a well-structured assessment system. Okay, well-structured assessment system. Okay, means that it's a guideline for the construction players to use in order to calculate the IBS score. Okay, so dia dah prepare guide dia daripada A sampai Z macam mana nak calculate, apa yang perlu calculate dan sebagainya. Okay, dalam manual ni set up the IBS score formula, ada formula dia nanti kita akan tengok. Ada IBS factor, why is IBS factor, also I am going to explain later. Okay. For each building element, semua dia dah bagi IBS factor ni. Methods of calculating, how to calculate also been explained is this, in this manual. Okay, explanatory note as well as sample calculation. Semua dah ada dalam manual tu tadi. Okay, which I also put in the slides as well. Okay, and it's also intended to provide a complete guidance for every professional to evaluate the IBS score for any building project. Okay, semua building project boleh gunakan this scoring system. Okay, tak ada halangan. Okay, so this is the principle. Okay, before you can start the calculation of IBS score, you need to know about the principle, syarat-syarat utama ni. Okay, so kalau tak ada benda ni, kalau tak ada salah satu ni, you tak boleh calculate IBS score. Kena ada this. Okay, the IAS scoring system emphasizes on the following attribute. Okay, ada four. Okay, the first one, usage of IBS component. Of course, nak guna IBS score, nak guna, nak calculate IBS score, you kena guna IBS. Okay, ini syarat basic lah. Okay, kalau project you tak ada guna IBS, macam ni you nak guna IBS score ni kan? So, ini syarat utama dia. Okay, you kena pakai IBS, barulah you boleh apply this IBS score. Okay. Okay, and the second one, standardized component based on Malaysian Standard 1064. Okay, I'm not sure whether Sir Reza has touched it or not. I think sepatutnya Sir Reza dah sentuh bahagian ni, especially masa dia explain about modular coordination, MC. So, kita ada sizes yang standard developed by Malaysian Standard 1064. Okay, size standard untuk column, size standard untuk beam, window, doors dan sebagainya. So, kita kena follow the sizes that has been stated in this Malaysian Standard 1064. Kena ada. Okay. Barulah kita boleh consider it as untuk calculate IBS score. Okay. Must be a element of repetition. Okay. Or structural layout. Grid tadi. Dalam my previous explanation, bila saya explain pasal konsep availability tu, salah satu design karakteristik dia adalah repetition. Okay, kita nak repetition vertically and horizontally. Berapa persen repeat? Okay, so the higher you repeat, the higher the score you can get. Okay, nanti kita akan pergi. And the last one is usage of other productivity enhancing solutions such as volumetric unit, beam and also MC. Okay, yang ini kena ada. Okay, kena pakai beam at least, kena ada salah satu lah. Okay, volumetric modular unit ni can be staircase. It can be toilet unit. Okay, kalau you pakai. Okay, kalau tak ada, maybe you boleh consider gunakan beam to design your IBS. Okay, of course, modular coordination. Kena ada. Okay, dalam you punya projects. Okay, these four principle, I can say is compulsory punya rules lah. Okay, kena ada empat ni, barulah you boleh calculate you punya IBS score. Kurang satu, perhaps your calculation is not being relevant. Okay, so you kena ada empat-empat ni. Okay, sebelum ni, ni antara the things that has been revised by CIDB. Ini yang terbaru, 2018. Okay, sebelum ni, 2005 dengan 2010, dia ada 5 principles. Okay, yang dia buang adalah masa 2005, in 2005, the IBS component must be produced at the factory. Itu syarat dia. Okay, tak boleh buat kat site, on site. Okay, sebab as you remember dalam nak buat precast ni, component precast ni, dia boleh buat sama ada at the factory or on site. Okay, sebab kalau site you besar dan sebagainya, you boleh buat kat situ. Okay, tapi masa 2005, CIDB agak take a drastic decision sebenarnya masa tu, whereby sebab masa tu kita baru nak encourage construction players to use IBS. Okay, so dia emphasize masa tu semua precast component kena buat kat kilang masa 2005. Okay, tapi again at early stage kita tak banyak sangat kilang IBS. Okay, so like today dah makin banyak. Okay, sebelum tu kurang. So masa, that's why masa 2010 CIDB revise this component principles whereby the precast component can be produced at the factory or on site. Okay, dia bagi option. Sebelum ni 2005 kena buat kat kilang sahaja. Okay, baru dia boleh consider IBS score. Okay, tapi masa 2010 dia revise, it's either one, sama ada you buat kat site ke ataupun buat kat kilang ke, you boleh consider IBS score. Untuk 2018, dia tak buang. Dia masukkan dalam, nanti saya akan tunjuk, dalam table. Okay, later I'm going to show you the reference table lah. Okay, cuma dia tak state dalam ni saja. Okay, yes, as I mentioned earlier, this IBS score can be applied on every building projects, okay, which include residential, sama ada landed or non-landed, commercial building, industrial building. Alah, ni tak tukar. Yang ini Aku pula nak buka. Boleh. Last one. Institutional building. Another. Okay, institutional. Nanti saya ubah lah. Nanti saya masuk. Okay. So, any type of building can use this IBS score. Okay. For any type of building. Okay. So, that's the basic thing you need to know about IBS score. Okay. So, belum boleh kira lagi. Okay. Kita tengok pula. Tadi dah kita dah tengok dia punya principles. We have a look the little bit on history, objective and also principles of IBS score. So, now we are going to dig more in depth about IBS content scoring system, whereby we are going to have a look on the, I can say, the rule of thumb lah, okay, of IBS score, dia punya syarat-syarat yang you perlu tahu. Okay, so there are five things that you need to know, okay, before you can start calculating the IBS score. Ada lima benda yang perlu tahu. First, the maximum IBS score for a building is 100 points. Okay, yang ini you kena tahu. Okay, walaupun is tu, tapi yang ditekankan di sini adalah building. Okay, for a building. Okay, maksudnya if your projects involve several building, okay, you are involving in mixed development project, katakan. Mixed development project, you have three building. Ada tiga bangunan. Okay, you have to calculate one by one. Building A berapa IBS score? Building B berapa IBS score dia? Building C berapa IBS score dia? And then after that, dia ada formula untuk calculate IBS score for the whole project. Okay, which I'm going to show later. Tapi you kena calculate building by building. Okay, you tak boleh campur sama. Alright, so that's the rule of thumb you kena tahu. Okay, sama macam you punya project, is a mixed development kan? Okay, ada tiga tower. Betul? Kalau seorang, saya tak ingat lah project dia.
Ya, yeah, betul.
Okay, ada tiga tower. Alright, so setiap tower tu you kena calculate IBS score dia. Tower A berapa, tower B berapa, tower C berapa. Okay, IBS score dia. So, maximum dia 100 untuk each building. Okay, that's the first thing you need to know. Right, the second thing you need to know is that the IBS score is made up of the following component. Okay, is divided into three component. The first component is part one, structural system. Maximum score dia 50. Okay, yang pertama adalah structural system. Okay, so dia akan bagi point lah. Okay, nanti I'm going to show you. Okay, again as I mentioned earlier, structural system involve three component. Column, beam and also flooring system kita. Itu yang membentuk structure kita. Okay, selain daripada roof. Itu also part of structural system. Okay, tapi dia one component lah, roof. Okay, tapi dia under this category. Roof, column, beam and also slab. Okay, 50 markah, 50 points. The second part is about wall system and the maximum score is 20 points, 20 markah. Okay, so the point awarded based on various type of wall system use. Okay, tak kisahlah ini apa you pakai, ada scoring dia. Nanti ada cara nak calculate dia. Okay, nanti saya tunjuk. And the last part is other simplified construction solution. The maximum score is 30 points. Okay, points awarded based on the usage of other simplified construction solution. Okay, kat sini lah kalau you pakai standardized component size and you follow Malaysian standard, ada markah. Repetition of structural layout, okay, horizontal, vertical, okay, ada markah. Kalau you pakai beam, ada markah. Kalau you pakai modular coordination, ada markah. Kat sini lah. Okay, kalau you pakai precast staircase dan sebagainya, kat sini lah markah. Alright, so this is the weightage score dia. 50, 20, 30. 50, 20, 30, we brings you a total of 100. Okay, ini yang di-revise oleh CIDB. Masa 2005, tak silap saya, 50, 30, 20. 50, 30, 20. 2010, diubah 50, 20, 30. 2018 masih sama. 50, 20, 30. Okay. So, among these three part, yang a little bit difficult to calculate is part one. Part 1 ni susah sikit, a little bit tricky to calculate. Okay, part 2, part 3 dah senang. Okay, never mind, nanti kita akan tengok. Alright. Okay, each part have their own what we call it as a reference table. Okay, part 1, we have reference table to determine IBS factor. Nanti I'm going to show you. Okay, part 2 have their own table also to use to refer the IBS factor. Okay, part 3, they have their own reference table, table 3, other simplified consensus solution. But in table 3, we determine direct point. Maksudnya, tak ada calculation sangat dekat part 3 ni. Okay, dekat table ni, dia dah dapat dah. Point dia berapa, masuk, just tambah terus saja. Okay, tapi untuk part 1 dan part 2 ni ada little bit calculation dia. Tapi tak adalah susah mana, jangan risau. Okay. So again, as I being mentioned just now, each table ni have their own each part have their own reference table. Okay, so the reference table is used to determine the IBS factor. Okay, why is IBS factor is derived from productivity studies done by CIDB. Okay, so given to each building system, whatever building system used in your construction project ada factor dia. Okay. So, you pakai steel ke, pakai precast ke, precast combine dengan steel ke, precast combine dengan timber ke, ada dia punya factor dia. Okay, nanti kita akan tengok. Okay, so the more billable system, the higher the factor and shorter construction time lah. Okay, lebih cepat. Okay, maksudnya lebih banyak you pakai IBS, lebih tinggi factor dia. Okay, IBS factor ni value dia adalah 0 to 1. Okay, value IBS factor dia, 0 to 1. Okay. Okay, ini simple. Alright, I think I uploaded this table also in the new feature. Ada kan? Orang? Anyone?
Ada.
Ada kan? Alright. So sebenarnya table ni ada dalam manual ni. Okay, saya keluarkan je. Alright, so this is table 1, IBS factor for structural system. Okay, so as you can see here, ada material or system yang digunakan pakai. Kalau you pakai concrete, you usable for work, ini bahagian dia. Yang ini ada bahagian metal atau steel, timber, block work, and kalau you pakai innovative system, ada bahagian dia. Okay, ini next column is column and beam. Yang ini column and beam 1 sampai 11. A sampai G is type of floor yang you pakai. Okay, so ini dia punya explanatory notes. Okay, ni tadi saya cakap factory precasting or site precasting. Dia tak buang, dia letakkan dalam table ni. Okay, dia tak masuk dalam principle sendirilah. Okay, ni table, ni untuk table 1A untuk IBS factor for roof. Yang ini for structural. Okay, yang melibatkan column, beam dengan floor. Okay, ini roof. And then table 2 is IBS factor for wall system. Okay, table dia pun tak se-complicated table 1 ni tadi kalau you boleh tengok. Okay, sebab ini lebih direct. Lebih direct. Okay, nanti kita akan tengok. Yang ini table 3. Nama dia pun berbeza. IBS score for other simplified. Table 1 and 2, dia nama IBS factor. Yang ini IBS score. Maksudnya direct point kat sini. Okay, 2, 4 dan sebagainya. Okay, ini dia punya komponen yang ada lah. Okay, nanti kita akan tengok macam mana nak guna lah. Okay, IBS factor dia again 0 to 1 lah, within 0 to 1. Okay, lebih banyak IBS you pakai, lebih tinggi factor. Okay, saya bagi contoh. Ini saya bagi contoh structural system using precast. Gunakan precast. Full precast. Okay, beam you precast, column you precast, flooring pun you pakai precast. Semua precast. So IBS factor you will be 1. Okay. Semua precast. Contoh table ni. Semua you pakai precast. Precast, column, beam. IBS slab you pun pakai precast, IBS factor you 1. Okay, itu cara you nak tengok lah. Okay, kalau you pakai precast beam tapi slab you pakai traditional. Okay, pakai timber forward 0.5 je, kurang sebab dia ada traditional. Okay. Okay, ni kalau combine precast in situ, traditional method. Okay, column dengan beam, you pakai traditional. Okay, flooring saja you pakai precast, hollow core slab. So, IBS factor you will be 0.6. Alright? Okay, 0.6, kurang. Sebab apa? Ada element of traditional kat sini. Okay, so that's why IBS factor you rendah. Okay, kalau steel construction, is IDS, satu lah. Okay, semua je pakai steel. Flooring, column and beam pakai steel, satu. Okay, that's how you determine you punya IBS factor. Okay, nanti kita akan explore more. Okay, ni yang ketiga. Yang pertama tadi, you kena ingat the maximum score for a building is 100 point. Okay, untuk satu bangunan, 100. Okay, yang kedua you kena tahu, dia terbagi kepada tiga bahagian. Part 1 structural system, part 2 wall system, part 3 is other simplified construction solution. And weightage score is 50, 20, 30, 50, 20, 30. Okay, so the next thing you need to know is the formula. Okay, so formula dia ada tiga bahagian, tiga formula. Alright, so maksudnya you kena kira satu-satu, part 1 dulu, then dah siap kira part 2, dah siap kira part 3, then you total up. And this is the formula. This is for part 1, this is for part 2, yang ni for part 3. Okay. 50, 20, yang ni 30. Okay. So, jangan risau. Okay, nampak formula dia macam menakutkan. Tapi, but it's quite simple actually. Okay, I'm going to show you later. Alright. So, no need to worry. Tak ada persamaan algebra ke persamaan linear ke bagai ke, tak ada. Okay, it's a simple calculation saja. Okay, tambah tolak kali bahagi. Okay. Alright, the rule number 4 that you need to know is that IBS score calculation consider superstructure only. Okay, so construction work will usually be divided into substructure and superstructure. Substructure ni kerja-kerja bawah tanah, atas tanah. Okay. Then bila dah naik atas tanah tu dah ada foundation, ground floor punya slab dan sebagainya, dan ke atas tu kita panggil superstructure. So IBS score only consider superstructure work only. So kerja-kerja foundation, kerja-kerja basement ke apa ke, kita tak consider as IBS score. Okay, so kita only consider superstructure work only. Alright, and the last one you need to know is in the case of a group of building in one project. Okay, as just now I mentioned, kalau project you mix development, okay, ada tiga bangunan ke lima bangunan dan sebagainya, there is a certain way you need to follow in order to calculate the IBS score for the whole project. Okay, you kena kira satu-satu bangunan, dan dapat satu IBS score for each building, then you have to calculate the overall. Okay, ada formula dia. Ini pun saya akan tunjuk later. Okay, ini pun you need to know because you are going to apply your assignment. Okay, so ada calculation tu. Okay, nak calculate IBS score for the whole project. Okay, so that's 5 things you need to know. Okay, maximum score 100 terbagi pada 3 bahagian, part 1, 2 and 3. Weightage dia 50, 20, 30, ada formula dia. Nombor 4, consider superstructure works only. And yang kelima adalah formula untuk calculate IBS score for the whole project. Okay, itu 5 benda yang kena tahu. Okay, ada soalan? Any questions? Before I'm going to show you two examples on how you can apply the formula involved in IBS score. Okay, so far okay?
So far okay.
Alright. Okay, kalau okay, we can continue. Okay, we have a look on the first example. Okay, I'm going to show the example on how you can calculate the IBS score. Okay, today I'm going to show you in theoretically on how you can apply the formula. Okay, next week kita akan buat exercise bersama-sama. Okay, on how you can apply. Okay. Okay, the first example is involving an UEM academic and IBS showcase. Okay, it's a transformation project from this old automotive workshop into this UM Academy and IBS Center. Okay, they transform okay, this old building into a new one. Okay, firstly you have to calculate the part 1. structural system or structural element. Okay. Okay, so this project is a two-story building. Dua tingkat, two-story. Okay, so first you, the first section is involving the ground floor, tingkat bawah, first floor, tingkat atas, and roof system. Okay, ini you kena divide area ni. And you kena calculate area dia. Okay, that's why dalam project you, you, saya minta you buat floor plan. Sebab apa, daripada floor plan you boleh calculate area. Sebab bila nak calculate IBS score, you perlu tahu area dia. Okay, so ini area for ground floor, 2,213 meter square. Okay, ini area for first floor, 1,576 meter square. Ini roof, ini area for the roof, 2,572 meter square. And the total construction area is 6,361 meter square. Okay, so this is IBS factor. Okay, this next column is IBS factor. Okay, ini komponen yang digunakan untuk ground floor. Structural system for ground floor, they are using steel beam and column, and slab they are using precast. So kalau you tengok kat sini, semua precast usually satu. Okay, so first floor, kenapa dia no floor kat sini? Sebab tingkat atas, tingkat satu dah tak ada floor atas ke. Okay, I'm going to explain to you further next week during our calculation lah. Okay, refer to table, you akan dapat satu juga. Alright, roof, prefab metal roof truss, ABS factor dia satu. Okay, so ini semua you dapat daripada table, reference table tadi. Okay, next column is involving coverage calculation. Okay, what you need to calculate here is the portion of the area. Okay, so as you can see here, 2,213 is the area for ground floor divide by total construction area, 6,361. Okay, you will get 0.34. Okay, first floor, the first area for first floor, 1,764. Okay, divide by total construction area, 6,361. Okay, and then roof area, 2,572. Divide by total construction area, 6,361. You get 0.4. Here you get 0.25. Okay, you total up, you akan dapat satu. Okay, lebih kurang lah. 3, 4 campur 5 campur. Okay, 0.99, lebih kurang lah satu. Okay, so make sure when you total up these three, kena dapat satu. Okay, ini one of the way you can check your calculation. You must get one here. Okay, kalau tak dapat satu kat sini, something wrong lah calculation ni kat sini. Kita salah tekan ke apa ke. Okay, kalau lahir sikit pun 0.99, tak apalah, tak ada masalah. Okay, jangan dapat 1.5 ke, jauh sangat, something wrong lah dengan calculation. Alright, you can check your calculation over here. Alright, okay, next step is calculation the IBS score. Okay, IBS score for ground floor, IBS score for first floor, IBS score for roof, then you total up. Okay, so we have a look on the calculation of IBS score for ground floor. Okay, so you take this coverage portion 0.34, okay, times IBS factor times 50. Why 50? Anyone? Kenapa you?
Because dekat component part 1 50.4 structural.
Yeah. Okay, because part 1 maximum score dia 50. Alright, portion dia 50. So that's why you have to time 50. Okay, that's the reason why you have time 50 here. Okay, so you times this one, you will get 17. Alright, and then repeat the same process untuk first floor. Portion first floor ni 0.25 times IBS factor, okay, 1 times 50. Okay, untuk roof, portion coverage ni 0.4 times IBS factor, 1 times 50. You will get 20. Okay, so you total up, you akan dapat 49.5. Okay, betul tak? 12.5 × 1 × 50 12.5 × 1 × 50 = 20. Okay, 49.5. This is the scoring, the IBS score for part 1. Okay, Here also you can check again. Okay, whereby dekat sini total ni make sure kurang 50. Kurang or sama dengan 50. Okay, kalau you dapat, you calculate total kat sini, tiba-tiba you dapat 60. Salah lah. Sebab maksimum dia 50. Okay, make sure dapat less than 50 kat sini. Okay, kalau lebih 50, ada something wrong lah dengan calculation you. You kena check kat mana-mana salah. Alright, so that's the way you calculate for part 1. Alright, for part 2, which involve wall element or wall system. Okay, so the wall system is divided into two. Okay, external and also internal wall. Okay, so you have to have a look on your detailed drawings. Okay, wall you. Jenis wall apa yang you pakai. Okay, sebab external wall kita ada four side. Dinding luar, ada four side. Kiri, kanan, depan, belakang. Okay, belah kanan maybe pakai lain. Belah kiri maybe pakai lain. Belakang pakai lain. Depan pakai lain. Okay, kalau semua sama tak ada masalah. Okay, so kalau lain-lain you kena identify. Okay, macam projek ni dia dia using different wall. Type of wall. Okay, precast concrete block maybe dia guna belah kanan. Okay, metal cladding maybe dia guna belakang. Okay, full height glass maybe belah depan. Okay, prefab timber panel maybe belah kiri. Alright, so you kena tengok drawing you berapa panjang wall. Okay, precast concrete block berapa panjang dia pakai? 108 meter. Metal cladding berapa panjang dia pakai? Okay, full height glass berapa panjang? Prefab timber panel berapa panjang dia pakai? Okay, ini semua dalam meter. So dia calculate in perimeter. Okay, so sama juga dengan internal wall. Okay, partition dalam, dinding dalam. Okay, so apa jenis dinding yang dia pakai? Okay, kat sini dia pakai precast block, drywall, metal cladding, prefab timber panel. And berapa length dia? Okay, berapa panjang untuk setiap jenis wall. So you kena calculate. Sama juga dengan project you, untuk assignment you. Okay, kalau you pakai satu jenis saja senang lah. Okay, you calculate dia semua. Okay, kalau banyak jenis you kena determine. Okay, internally jenis dinding apa you pakai dan sebagainya. Okay, so you kena kira length of every type of wall that has been used in your project. And then you total up. Okay. Sampai you dah identify ni. Dah calculate panjang ni setiap satu. Then you total up semua ni. Then you akan dapat 1363. Total wall length in your construction project. External and also internal. Alright. And then you tengok IBS factor tu pula. Sama konsep. Refer to table 2 pula tadi. Sekarang. Tadi table 1. So precast concrete block daripada table apa IBS factor ni. Okay, ini semua boleh dapat daripada table. Okay, and then coverage, sama konsep, okay. Length of this precast concrete block, 108, divide by total wall length, 1363. Bagikan, you akan dapat 0.08. Okay, repeat the same process for metal cladding, 96, divide by 1363, dan seterusnya. Okay, sama, proses dia macam tadi. Okay, panjang dinding tu bagi dengan total dinding, keseluruhan. And then you total up, make sure again dapat satu maksimum. Okay. And then next part, you calculate IBS score for wall system. Calculate IBS score for wall system. Okay. So kat sini untuk precast concrete block, coverage dia 0.08. Okay, you take from here. Times IBS factor, 1. And then times 20. Why 20? Anyone? Kenapa 20?
20 point dekat wall element.
Yes, okay, because wall element or wall system, maximum score dia adalah 20. Okay, that's why you have to times 20. So, tadi times 50, untuk wall system you times 20. Okay, konsep dia sama. Cuma yang membezakan dia adalah dekat sini. 20 ni tadi. Okay, and dengan dekat sini dia pakai meter lah. Structural dia pakai area. Alright, so you times, you dapat 1.6. Okay, repeat all the process, the same process. Then you total up, you dapat 15. Okay, so again, make sure total kat sini must be less or equal 20. If more than 20, something wrong dengan calculation ni. Okay, that's the way you can check your calculation. First kat sini, second kat sini you boleh check. Okay, must be less than 20. Okay, so that's how you calculate the part 2. Okay, part 3 is other simplified construction solution. Yang ini dipanggil direct score. Okay, yang ini little bit senang lah boleh saya calculate. Okay, kita ada tiga tiga elemen dekat part 3 ni. Okay, standardized component, repetition of structural layout, ada prefab component and labor saving devices. Okay, so ini standardized component based on Malaysian Standard 1064. Beam, column, slab, door, windows. Okay, semua lebih 75%. Sama size dia. Okay, so kalau lebih, markah ada 4. Okay, kalau you tengok table tu dalam reference table, ada 2 portion of percentage. 50 ke 75%, 75 ke 100%. Okay. Table 3. Okay, ada 2 portion. 50, 75, 75 ke 100. Okay, so 50, 75 markah dia rendah sikit 2. 75 ke 100 markah dia tinggi. Okay, sama juga dengan kat sini. Okay, so masukkan markah dia terus kat sini. Tak ada calculate apa-apa, masukkan saja dalam table. Okay, sama juga repetition. Ini bangunan dia projek you 1 ke 2 tingkat. Skor dia 6. Okay. And toilet unit dan staircases dia pakai. So markah dia 2. Semua dapat daripada table. Okay. So total up, you akan dapat 30. Okay, untuk keseluruhan. Maximum skor dia 30. Okay, yang dekat calculation part 3 ni, you boleh dapat lebih dari 30. Okay, bila you tambah ni semua, kadang-kadang ada komponen lebih kat sini, you akan dapat 30 lebih, 40 ke. Tapi still, you boleh ambil 30 sahaja. Walaupun you dapat 40. Maksimum dia 30 je. Cap dia. You boleh pergi 30 je. Kalau lebih daripada tu, tak boleh. Ini sebab dia direct score. Dia lain dengan part 1 dengan part 2 tadi. Yang ini you boleh pergi lebih 30, tapi still maksimum you boleh letak 30 sahaja. Itu syarat untuk part 3. Alright, then you total up ketiga-tiga part. You dapat 94.5 points untuk IBS score untuk this project. Okay, ini saya ubah sikit, ada silap sikit calculation dia tu. Okay, nanti saya akan masukkan yang baru dalam new feature later. Okay, ada soalan? Untuk first example.
Doktor.
Ya.
Yeah. Ni pas contohlah 94.5 ni kira per, apa point dia per 100 lah kan? Dia
yes.
Tahap penggunaan dia.
Yes, per 100.
Okay.
Okay, so kalau dia government project, dia lulus lah. Sebab dia government project kena lebih 70. Ada soalan lain? Okay, kalau tak ada, kita tengok second example. Okay, example ni is a high-rise project ni example. Okay, ni floor plan dia. Dia 80-story condominium. Okay, project you 30 tingkat lah. Right? Betul?
Betul.
Alright, your project is 30 story. Okay, yang ini I give you example 18 story condominium. Okay, this is the floor plan. Okay, dekat apa nama dia ni? This project dia ada setiap floor dia ada 6 unit rumah. Okay, dia ada lift lobby area. Okay, dia ada 6 unit setiap floor. Okay, ini detail dia. Construction area dia, area for one unit of condominium, 94.4 meter square. Okay, untuk satu unit. Okay, lift lobby area ni, 140 meter square. So, area for one floor, untuk keseluruhan floor ni, 94.4 kali 6 unit, dia ada 6 unit kondo, tambah 140 untuk lift lobby ni. So, dia dapat 706. Okay, this is the total construction area untuk satu floor, satu tingkat. Okay, structural system dia pakai tunnel formwork. Roof truss dia pakai prefab steel roof truss. Okay, wall system, internal dia pakai precast blockwork. External wall and wall at lobby dia pakai tunnel formwork. Pakai satu jenis saja untuk internal and external. Okay, dia dah calculate, dah bagi dah length dia. Alright, so this is detail, ada simplified construction solution. Door dengan window saja dia pakai, dia comply dengan Malaysian standard. Okay, repetition of floor to floor height 90%, vertical repetition of structural floor layout 80%. Okay, dia pakai 100% prefab staircase. Okay, kita calculate structural part 1 structural element. Okay, satu tingkat area dia 706.4 meter square and dia ada 18 tingkat. Okay, kalau dia tengok kenapa dia boleh kali 18 sebab size dia standardized for every floor. Tapi kalau projek you buat size dia berbeza, you kena calculate lah 30 tingkat tu tadi. Tingkat 1 berapa, tingkat 2 berapa, tingkat 3 berapa dan sebagainya. Tapi kalau size standardized untuk setiap tingkat, just time 18 terus saja. Okay, simple. Okay, that's is IBS all about. Okay, about standardization. Okay, so dia kali 18, you dapat total construction area dia 12,715 meter square untuk 18 tingkat ni. Okay, untuk roof area, different component 706. Okay, you total up 13,421.4 okay, untuk total construction area. IBS factor dia, dia pakai tunnel formwork 0.5. Okay, walaupun tunnel ni formwork system ni adalah IBS, tapi again, kenapa IBS factor dia kurang? Sebab again, formwork system ni dia ada element of traditional. Sebab tu IBS factor dia kurang. Okay, so roof truss dia pakai prefab steel 1. So sama proses dia, coverage nak calculate 12,715 ni bagikan dengan 13,000. Okay, you akan dapat 0.95. Then 706.4 bagi total construction area, you akan dapat 0.05. Alright, and then after that coverage ni 0.95 kali IBS factor kali 50, you akan dapat this one 23.75. Okay, sama repeat the same process untuk roof area 2.5, total up you dapat 26.25 untuk part 1 for this project. Okay, part 2, okay, internal wall dia pakai precast block work. Well, length dia satu untuk satu unit 25.2 meter. Kita ada 6 unit, kita ada 18 tingkat. So you kali kan, you akan dapat this total. Okay, sama juga external wall 41.06 meter, ada 6 unit, ada 18 tingkat. Dapat this one. Wall and lobby dia pakai tunnel. Okay, 17.3, ada 18 tingkat, 311.4. Total up 74.67.5 meter untuk total wall length. Okay, sama proses dia, IBS factor determine from table. Okay, ini tunnel pun saya tak tukar lah. Patut 0.5 ni. Sorry. Nanti saya ubah balik. Saya edit kan, saya masukkan. Lupa nak ubah. Okay, sebab yang ini 0.6 ni kenapa saya tak ubah? Sebab 2010 0.6 tunnel formwork ni. 2018 ni yang baru, dia kurangkan 0.5. Okay. So itu antara perubahan yang dibuat dalam dalam the new manual lah 2018 ni. Okay, so sama proses coverage 0.3 kali this one you dapat ni bagi total. Okay, dapat 0.36 then kali dengan 0.5 kali dengan 20 untuk part 2 you dapat 3.6. Okay, repeat same process, total up you dapat 11.16. Okay, untuk part 2. Okay, untuk part 3 dia tak banyak. Okay, staircase pun saya tak masukkan dalam ni. Tadi dia pakai staircase, prefab staircase. Okay, patut ada masuk lah. Nanti saya edit ni. Okay, so total up ini directly dapat dari table, you dapat 12. Okay, then you total part 1, 2 and 3, 49.41. Okay, that's for this project. Okay, quite low lah sebab dia pakai tunnel forward. Tunnel forward, IBS factor dia kurang. So that's why dia punya scoring akan kurang. Okay, so dia kena pakai IBS yang lebih advanced lah. Okay. Ada soalan?
Doktor, yang factor tu boleh dapat daripada jadual tadi kan? Yang
sebelum yes, table tadi. Reference table, table 1, 2, 3 tadi.
Okay.
Semua boleh dapat di situ. Okay, kalau tak ada soalan, kita tengok last part. Yang ini just for your knowledge, kita boleh tengok macam mana Singapore buat because most of action taken by CIDB lebih kurang macam Singapore buat. Okay, tapi Singapore buat, I can say it's more systematic. Okay, lebih tersusun. Okay, compare to CIDB lah. CIDB tak adalah teruk sangat tapi lebih kemas lah susunan dekat Singapore tu. Kita boleh tengok lah little bit. Okay, this some introduction on the sexual adoption of LGBT concept in Singapore. Okay, the first introduced in Singapore in 1991. Okay, the concept of LGBT ni has been introduced in Singapore in 1991 by CIDB of Singapore. Okay, tapi lepas tu dia tukar nama jadi BCA, Building Control Authority, BCA lah. So now in Singapore then they are not using CIDB anymore. They guna BCA. Okay. So masa 1991 ni, they introduced and they develop what we call it as a Buildable Design Appraisal System, BDAS, a scoring system to measure the potential impact of building design on the usage of site labor. Okay, walaupun definition dia quite different, tapi konsep dia sama macam kita punya IBS content scoring system yang kita pakai sekarang, 2018. Okay, sama je, lebih kurang. Okay, tak adalah totally sama tapi lebih kurang. Alright, cuma nama dia beza BDAS tapi dia perkenalkan 1991 lagi. Kita dikenalkan kita punya content scoring system tu 2005. Okay, dia 1991 lagi dia dah perkenalkan. Okay, so bila dia perkenalkan, dia promote. Promote it, initiated an annual Best Buildable Design Award competition. Okay, dia perkenalkan competition. Dia bagi recognition to designers and contractors. Okay, siapa yang design cantik, pakaikan Buildable Design atau pakai MBS, scoring tinggi, dia bagi award. Okay. After 10 years, in 1 January 2001, they make it legislated. Maksudnya dia wajibkan, compulsory, for every construction project in Singapore to use this BDAS. Okay, they took 10 years to create awareness for the construction players to use IBS in their country. 10 years to promote. Okay. So, they legislated, okay, dia jadikan code of practice. Okay, they applies to all new residential commercial industry, any building type of gross floor area 5,000 meter square and more. Okay, so diwajibkan untuk semua jenis bangunan yang lebih 5,000 meter square yang ke atas. Okay, new extension, renovation work dan sebagainya yang lebih 5,000 meter square pun wajib. Pun wajib pakai this scoring system ni, BDAS lah. Kecuali dia bagi kecualian places of worship, masjid dan sebagainya, especially utility. Okay, maybe ada security punya bangunan dan sebagainya, dikecualikan lah. Okay. Alright, so dia perkenalkan dan setiap apa ni, dia ada dia punya prosedur lah. Then they need to follow. Okay, dia submit untuk application untuk building approval. They need to submit also with the scoring system. Okay, I'm not sure kat Malaysia ni dah wajibkan ke belum. I think even though kita ada 70% so still dia punya implementation masih rendah. Okay, Malaysia. Okay, apa yang membezakan dia adalah dari code of practice. Dia panggil code of practice. Okay, kita panggil construction industry standard tadi, CIS. Okay, dia panggil code of practice. Okay, dia ada. Semua yang dia ada tulis kat sini kita ada. Okay, cuma yang kita tak ada adalah this one. Okay, yang dah tak ada minimum buildability score. Yang ni tak ada. Okay, apa minimum score ni, I'm going to show you later. Tapi pada 2001 dia perkenalkan. Okay, dia punya portion dia 50, 40, 10. Okay, komponen dia sama, 3 bahagian, sama macam kita. Okay, cuma nama dia beza kat sini sikit lah. Ada buildable design features. Tapi weightage dia beza, 50, 40, 10. Kita 50, 20, 30. Okay. Okay, apa yang dimasukkan minimum buildability score ni? Kita tengok pada first implementation, bila diwajibkan in January 2001, dia ada minimum buildability score ni. Okay. Kita tak payah tengok yang lain lah. Kita tengok yang ni saja. Contoh, satu contoh saja. Residential landed 5,000 ke 25,000 meter square. Kalau you buat landed punya housing kat Singapore, you punya minimum score kena 52. Okay, kalau lebih 25,000, you punya minimum score kena 55. Okay, maksudnya kat sini, kalau you buat, you design you punya residential project dalam contoh kita sekarang ni, you design, you calculate IBS score you, you dapat cuma, let's say you dapat 40 je, you pakai. Okay, kat sini. You pun submit pada building authority dia dekat Singapore. They will reject your punya proposal. Okay, you, they ask you to revise sampai you, you dapat minimum score you 52. Baru you boleh proceed ke next stage. Itu yang dimasukkan dengan minimum score kat Singapore. You kena follow minimum score. Baru you boleh proceed. Okay, kalau dapat less than this, your proposal will be rejected. Okay, itu yang dimasukkan dengan minimum score. Ni kat Singapore. Okay, ni 1 January 2001. After that, after almost 5 years, September 2005, they revise. Okay, the new work. Kalau tadi start dengan 5,000, sekarang ni project 2,000 meter square dah kena ada minimum score dia. Okay, 52. Kalau tadi 5,000 tadi ni, 52 kan? Okay, sekarang ni dah jadi 59. Kalau tadi 55, yang kat sini dah jadi 62. Dia naik dah sikit. Okay, selepas hampir 5 tahun. Alright. Alright, in September 2005 pun dia perkenalkan new category ANA. ANA ni alteration and additional work. Ni maksudnya untuk kerja-kerja renovation. Renovation works pun ada dia punya minimum score. Okay. And then January 2007 dia revise and August 2008 dia revise lagi sekali. Okay. Kalau dia tengok tadi 2007 65 62 65. Okay. Tadi dia start dengan berapa? 52 55. 2001 masa 2001. Dia start 52 55 masa 2001. Okay. So 2008 tak lebih kurang almost 2 years, tahun lebih. Dia revise lagi. Jadi 65 68. Makin lama makin naik. Alright, in 2008. Okay. 2015 dia revise lagi. Sekarang dah jadi 78 81. Okay, tadi start 52 kan? Yang ni start 55. Okay, selepas 2001 start almost 15 years, 14 tahun, 15 tahun. Dia naik 78 tolak 52, 26 lebih kurang skor ni. And tahun 2015 ni dia punya portion dah berubah. 45, 45, 10. Okay, kalau tadi 50, 20, 30, sekarang jadi 45, 45, 10. Okay, for information sebenarnya part 3 ni paling senang nak skor. Sebab dia lebih lebih kepada size komponen dan sebagainya. Senang nak score kat sini. That's why Singapore letak 10 je. Dia tahu senang nak score. Letak 10. Okay, kat Malaysia 30. Okay, sebab dia tahu dia nak tolong. CDB want to help because I'm supposed to get higher score. Okay, sebab kat sini paling senang nak score kat part 3 ni. Okay. And the latest one, April 2017. Okay. Okay, then sekarang tadi berapa? 78-81 pun sama, masih sama. 78-81. Okay, cuma yang berubah adalah this one. And maximum score dia pun dah jadi 110 kat Singapore. Okay, so sekarang dah 110 lah in Singapore. Yang lain sama kot macam ni. Okay, cuma yang berubah masa 2017 ni adalah scoring system ni. Okay, 20. And they introduce new category for basement 68. So basement work pun dia dah boleh calculate IBS score in Singapore. Okay, kita masih belum lagi lah so far. Alright, so substructure work in Singapore dah boleh calculate. Okay, that's all for today. Ada soalan? Any question?
Doktor,
yes.
Berkenaan dengan yang contoh macam external wall tu, kita kira kalau external kita kira macam external sahajalah kan?
Ya, external sahajalah. Internal, okay. Internal sahajalah. Ini macam contoh floor plan ni tadi. Okay. Okay, kalau external dinding luar je lah. Dinding luar ni, semua ni. Yang luar-luar ni external lah.
Okey, nak contoh okay. Kira dia macam mana?
Meter, perimeter. Panjang ni berapa tambah? Tambah. Tu dah panggil perimeter. Okey, tambah. Kalau ni 5 meter, yang ni berapa? 3 meter, tambah 3, 8 meter. Yang ni 1 meter, 9. Yang ke sini maybe 1 meter lagi, 10. Yang ni ke bawah ni maybe 3 meter, 13. 10 campur 3, 13 meter. Okey, dia kira perimeter. Okey, sama juga dengan dinding dalam. Dinding dalam ni, yang ni berapa panjang? 3 meter. Yang ni 2 meter lah. 3 campur 2, 5 meter. Okey, itu kalau guna satu jenis wall. Okey, kalau you guna wall berbeza. Okey, contoh you ada part macam ni kan. Yang ni you gunakan block work. Yang ni you gunakan precast. Yang ni gunakan metal. Yang ni you gunakan timber. Okey, yang ni katakan tadi apa? Block work. Berapa panjang ni? 2 meter. Okey, block work 2 meter. Precast berapa meter? Tapi kalau you guna semua jenis yang sama, dia totalkan lah. 2 meter campur maybe ni 6, ni 2, ni 6. Okay, 2 campur 6, 8, 10, 16 meter. So total external wall you 16 meter. Boleh, Aziz?
Boleh. Okay.
Any more question? Anyone else? Okay, kalau tak ada dalam saya check saya tak sure saya dah okay. Dalam U Future I dah masukkan IBS core exercises. Okay, so perhaps maybe you boleh try dulu. Okay, boleh try dulu during your free time dalam minggu ni. Okay, sebab next week of course saya akan guide you. Saya akan tunjukkan macam mana nak calculate. But maybe you boleh try it first on how to calculate. Okay, ni ada dua exercise lah. Exercise satu dengan dua. Okay, exercise dua tu maybe you tak boleh buat lagi lah. Susah sikit nak buat. Okay, exercise one ni maybe you boleh try dulu. Okay, so try buat dulu. Okay. Kalau start ke tak faham ke tak apa, never mind. Nanti saya akan guide you lah next week kita akan buat bersama-sama this exercise, but it's good for you to try it first lah, okay, before kita buat bersama-sama next week. Okay, kalau tak ada soalan, I think we can end up our session today. Next week we are going to continue with the exercises. Okay, IBS core tu tadi, exercise yang saya tunjuk tadi. Okay, sama using U Future ni, using Google Meet. Okay, saya akan tunjuk, share dalam video conferencing ni lah. Okay, on how to calculate IBS core. Okay, so that's all for today. Thank you for your time and commitment. See you next week. Don't forget to take your attendance. Take care and stay safe. Thank you. Assalamualaikum and morning.
Waalaikumsalam.
Salam dekat kita.
Alright.
Thank you, Doctor. Assalamualaikum.
Assalamualaikum. Welcome.